I really don't know for sure when I saw my first pornography, my first dirty picture, as we used to call them, but I totally remember being like 5 or 6 years old and knowing exactly which issues of National Geographic had pictures of topless women in them. Women from faraway, exotic places where they seldom, if ever, wore blouses. And I was just a little boy, but I liked looking at those pictures. I assume in retrospect that while some part of my fascination was simple curiosity or biology, another part was most certainly this. I knew that if my parents caught me looking at those pages, I'd get in trouble. Nothing severe like being grounded from TV, for example, and probably not an actual spanking, but I would definitely get a good talking to. And about subjects, female anatomy, probably, that I knew I did not want to discuss with my parents, especially my mother. And that created a kind of a taboo, a feeling of transgressive behavior, the juvenile delight of doing something you know you're not supposed to do. And that feeling for me, and I suspect for most consumers of pornography, never quite goes away. It's a part of the experience, a delightfully ever-present part of the experience, indulging in taboo behavior. It's a feeling that's with us when we sneak our first puff of a cigarette or steal a quarter out of mom's purse or try our first taste of booze or weed or whatever. It's a good feeling mostly, secretive and self-indulgent and quite possibly dangerous or even bad for you. People love it. I did too, as I continued to sneak looks at those pages in those magazines. And what was happening is that this little boy was learning to objectify, to enjoy the feeling of seeing something in a woman's body that maybe I shouldn't be looking at, even if I really wanted to. Now, I know that's not exactly the definition of objectifying, but it does describe a big part of the action of objectification and the attendant personal reinforcement mechanism that gets young men looking and looking and more or less teaches them that looking is okay. There's even a name for it. It's called the male gaze, and that might sound really simple, but it's not. It's an incredibly rich and even fraught topic. It was known as le regard by the French philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre, who noted that the act of gazing at another human being creates a subjective power difference between the gazer and the object of his or her gaze. Later on, it was actually dubbed the male gaze by the feminist film theorist Laura Mulvey. In film, it has three parts. Think of the movie Rear Window, and think of Jimmy Stewart looking at Grace Kelly, that's part one. Then think of Alfred Hitchcock directing those scenes, that's part two. And then think of all the guys and gals in all the movie theaters all over the world watching it, that's part three. Gaze, gaze, gaze. Sigmund Freud used the word scopophilia to describe the pleasure drawn from looking at an object or a person which he considered to be a component instinct innate to early stages of psychosexual development, basically our personalities. Add a T to this word and it becomes scoptophilia, which describes the specifically sexual pleasure that a person derives from looking at prurient objects of eroticism such as pornography and the nude body. And though I was most certainly not aware of all this psychological mumbo jumbo, I also was most certainly starting to live it, to wit. At some point after my timid explorations with the National Geographic Society, I discovered another fine publication, the Sears Roebuck catalog, which promised the potential fulfillment of all my boyhood acquisitional fantasies. And in this catalog, just past the more mundane jungle gems of my juvenile desires, beyond the BB guns and guitars and kick-ass telescopes, were pages where I could surreptitiously gaze with wonderment upon other mysterious and unexplored celestial bodies. The women's underwear section. It was alluring and confusing all at the same time. I was drawn to these images too, but had no idea why, much less any idea whatsoever what I would do if, say, scantily clad woman from those pages could magically show up at my doorstep in a big box from the Sears Roebuck company. no idea at all, despite the delightfully alluring, if even more confusing, suggestion put forth by one particular album cover in my parents' record collection. Now maybe you're thinking, oh, these things are not really porn. Sure, perhaps they were titillating to one weird little boy named Norm like 50 years ago, but really it's not pornography, and it's certainly not intended to be titillating. So maybe now is a good time to start and try to define what is pornography. Webster's definition is fairly straightforward. The depiction of erotic behavior as in pictures or writing intended to cause sexual excitement. A more cunning linguist, however, might dive deeper into the word in its native tongue and share its actual etymology. It's from the Greek, where porno means prostitute and graphein means write or depict, plus a suffix y, which in this case means relating to. So pornography, anything relating to writing about or depicting prostitutes. That's how it started. But almost everybody has their own definition of what pornography is, as do you all, as you know. And I'm going to read some of them right now. Thanks for taking part. Pornography is any material, medium, object that is designed to arouse the senses and to titillate. And this from a porn star named Steen Canal. Jiggs Spring Street defines pornography as, pornography is in the mind of the befeeler. Buttons Orchid says, not sure, but I know it when I see it, also wasted on the young. Shy May says, pornography is a visual medium with the purpose of eliciting sexually arousing reaction from its viewer. Buddy Bullshead, Rhinebeck area, says, pornography is videos of poor people fucking. Rusty Avenue Z says, erotica and objectification, mostly men towards women. And somebody who doesn't have a porn star name says, pornography is inevitable. Last but not least, Kara Columbus says pornography is complicated. So true. It's not surprising that there would be a gajillion different definitions of pornography, because it's really been around for about a gajillion years. The very first suspected pornographic image, and I actually don't personally think that it matches any of the definitions that I like, is the Venus of Willendorf, which is dated around 23,000 to 30,000 BC or so, and is one of numerous Venus figurines surviving from Paleolithic Europe. No one knows, of course, exactly what it was and why it was, but the consensus seems to be that it was actually some kind of a fertility fetish, which in this case means an inanimate object worshipped for its supposed magical powers or because it is considered to be inhabited by a spirit, though some scholars do consider that it might have served no other purpose than to be titillating, in which case it would be the world's first known pornographic image. 16 millennia further on came this clay figurine of a fertility goddess from Iran. Same thing, probably not meant strictly to be titillating. But fast forward another five short millennia to the cradle of civilization, where the Sumerians and Babylonians were happily living in Mesopotamia and making a lot of sculptures that looked like this, or this, or this. As you might guess, there's not a lot of dissent in archaeological circles as to whether this stuff was pornography or not. Moving up the timeline here to 1150 BC, there's the Turin Erotic Papyrus, an ancient papyrus scroll painting discovered in Egypt and dubbed the world's first men's mag. This is what it actually looks like, and this is what the expert archaeologists have speculated it once looked like. Original and speculated. You kind of can't help but think that to some degree it's a blank canvas upon which the experts are projecting what's actually on their minds. People see what they want to see, and one of the things that they have always wanted to see is pornography. Well, starting around 480 BC, the Greeks did a bang-up job delivering the goods, creating images that lived up to their very own definition of the word. And many, many of them actually do depict prostitutes at work. The little thing on the wall above this coupling is a money pouch, which designates this as a scene representing sex for hire. The ancient Greeks also depicted a lot of what came to be known as doing Greek, between men and women. And they had a special affinity, evidently, for this thing called spit roasting. Fast forward to the Roman towns of Pompeii and Herculaneum, which had developed reputations as the whore towns of the ancient world. We know this because in 79 AD, Mount Vesuvius buried them both under layers of lava and ash, giving new meaning to their ancient tourism slogan. Later excavation provided a fairly well-preserved glimpse of what actually was happening in Pompeii, depicting in reliefs and frescoes and in color. And here's a feller with a fantastic Johnson, a recurring theme in pornographic art, presumably created by men with mere mortal-sized members. Pictures showing various positions abound: cunnilingus, doggy style, threesomes, cowgirl, and even some of this position with half man, half goat Greek god Pan tending to the flocks. Well, one of the flocks anyway. I think that's Billy. Down in India, around about 350 AD, they were writing and illustrating the Kama Sutra, which describes 245 different sex positions, all of which can be seen in this one Indian temple. And all of this stuff, definitely pornographic, perhaps educational too, but certainly meant to titillate. Same with the pornographic images of the Moche civilization over in what is now Peru, not leaving a lot to the imagination. Meanwhile, back in Europe, in the late 1300s, the Middle Ages, Christian pilgrims who visited holy sites would buy souvenirs at those sites called pilgrim badges. They were the Middle Ages equivalent of the bumper sticker that says Sea Rock City or South of the Border or This Car Climbed Mount Washington. Many of them were really very bawdy, like this enormous phallus being stroked by two women, or this even more enormous phallus with legs, or of course this vulva wearing a crown being carried by three penises with tails. Meanwhile, back in the good old US of A, way before it was the good old US of A, a Cherokee ceremonial pipe from the 1400s gives us a different sort of glimpse into what some of the first peoples were up to.
Is that stone?
Around 1680 AD, the Japanese entered the scene with amazing little sculptures called Shunga Netsuke, primarily carved from ivory and bone and depicting all manner of coital enjoyments. They were meant to be both illustrative and erotic, and this stuff definitely counts as porn in my book, especially when my book is the Encyclopedia Britannica, which defines porn thusly: representation of sexual behavior in books, pictures, statues, motion pictures, and other media that is intended to cause sexual incitement. And most of this Netsuke stuff, if not a little confounding, certainly seems to have the intention of causing sexual excitement, at least for some. 700 dog years later, in the 18th century Ottoman Empire, the recreational activities of that era were being captured in style by painters and illustrators who were highly trained in their specialized craft. And one of the things that really struck me pulling all this together is that I sort of imagine that a lot of these things were sort of modern inventions created by some prep school pervert with a hyphenated last name or a creative gentleman in Provincetown wearing a t-shirt that says, I am the man from Nantucket. But no, all of this stuff has been around forever and ever. For example, in the Mughal Empire, whole pornographic books were written and illustrated detailing some really very interesting ideas about sex. Man getting screwed by the devil, woman riding a giant penis bird, women doing very well without a penis, thank you very much, and devil woman doing very well with a giant penis. Man with game, looks like a deer, and man evidently without any game, relegated to find release on a sex doll while getting pegged by some sort of weird double dong contraption. About the same time, over in England, Fanny Hill, or Memoirs of a Woman of Pleasure, was published. It detailed the life of a London prostitute and was condemned straight away as pornographic, and so naturally became a bestseller right away. Same dynamic a few years later when the infamous Marquis de Sade published 120 Days of Sodom, and after that, Justine, subtitled The Misfortunes of Virtue. Later on in Georgian England, under the reign of King George IV, the masses were just crazy for pornography, and artists of the day were all too happy to satisfy these desires, and none had more renown than one Thomas Rowlandson, whose bawdy illustrations portrayed mostly straight, mostly white, mostly male fantasy-based, mostly explicit intercourse scenes, which were all the rage right up until 1839, when Louis-Jacques Mandé Daguerre invented the daguerreotype process in France, the first photographs. Of course, it took about a hot half a second until this new technology was being used to create pornography, straight porn, gay porn. One online article noted that by 1860 in Paris alone, there were estimated to be 400 shops selling pornographic photos like these. Four short decades later, moving pictures were invented, and you guessed it, erotic film came hot on its tail. 1896 brought us the very first erotic movie, Le Coucher de la Mariée, or Bedtime for the Bride, which is basically a 7-minute striptease set on a couple's wedding night. Certainly the longest 7 minutes of that guy's life. And that brings us right up to the 20th century, which, notwithstanding the Turin erotic papyrus, is the dawn of the era of the men's magazine, also known as girly magazines, skin mags, lad mags, wank mags, and so on and so on. In the early part of the century, there were pretty tame repositories of body humor and racy illustrations with titles like L'Amour, French Frolics, Follies, Cupid's Capers, Man's Life, Four Men, High Heel, Wink, Titter, and Stag. Naturally, an appetite for racier fare developed, and the magazine world, of course, smelling increased profits, was all too happy to cater to it with titles like Man, Rogue, and Cheesecake. Now, cheesecake was an American slang word that became a publicly acceptable term for racy photos of scantily clad women because the word pinup was actually considered taboo in the early 20th century. But by mid-century, in December 1953, these glossy skin mags were joined by a precocious new kid on the block when the very first issue of Playboy came out. It featured Marilyn Monroe on the cover, but also Marilyn Monroe topless inside. It was, as you'd imagine, an instant hit amongst competition like Champagne, Ace High, Manhood, Modern Man, and Dame. And here, just for kicks, are some of the covers from Playboy's first year of publication. You can see how it's trying to be kind of an all-around men's lifestyle magazine. Playboy tours the hottest spots in Paris. Country Club Playmate. The magazine was both creating the appetite for and inventing the post-war fantasy of the sophisticated, urbane gentleman perv. featuring modern art and college football and, of course, college cheerleaders. Playboy went on, under the remarkable leadership of Hugh Hefner, to have so many gorgeous covers and amazing interviews, and to feature some of each era's very best writers, Allen Ginsberg and Vladimir Nabokov in this issue, and to feature the most beautiful and talented women on its covers, many of whom were so iconic they only needed one name: Farrah, Dolly, Beau, Drew, Madonna, Cindy, Kim, Kardashian, and Kate. And of note, long before American Vogue, Elle, Harper's Bazaar, and most other general interest or fashion magazines had a black woman on their covers, Playboy did, featuring Doreen Stern in this really gorgeous cover. Playboys could be found everywhere, everywhere from the well-heeled bachelor's modern living room to gas station waiting areas to nearly every single old man barbershop my parents ever took me to. Now, I couldn't actually look at them with my parents sitting right there and all, but somehow I knew what was inside. The Holy Grail, pictures of naked women. And I knew that someday all my practice objectifying would pay off and I would get to see those photos themselves in the flesh. My best guess is that that day came years later after I moved to Cincinnati, Ohio. One of my first friends there was a kid named Bill, and I would go over to Bill's house to play, and unbeknownst to my parents, the play would largely consist of sneaking into Bill's dad's bedroom and poking through the stacks of Playboys that he kept there right next to his bed. He kept his porn stash right next to the bed, a stack just like the ones I've recreated here in this gallery, and oh God, did we enjoy hanging out at Bill's house. But Playboys were not just an object of fascination for the young. They were mentioned in popular songs and featured in movies and joked about by comedians. And I even remember Johnny Carson on The Tonight Show joking that there's a new Playboy out for married men. It's a picture of the same woman every month, forever. And all this joking and referencing and whatnot, well, it had the effect of increasing the normalization of porn and the male gaze in our still somewhat puritanically repressed American society and in my little boy mind. And that normalization from those comedians and movies and songs often included mention of the activity that goes hand in hand with pornography, masturbation. As Tom Waits called it, making the scene with the magazine. And though I had never personally tried that at such a young age, I feel that I had already been successfully instructed by all these societal forces on exactly how a young man should do it when the time comes. And it always began with getting a dirty picture. Pornography had arrived in our culture and in my life, and Playboy really was chauffeuring its stretch limousine. And just like that, the word pinup ceased to have any stigma attached to it at all. The success of Playboy, they even had a Braille edition, sent sales of all dirty magazines right through the roof. And the whole market really took off fast. And as most young markets do when they grow and mature, this market for flesh underwent extreme and untethered specialization and segmentation as publishers found it in their best financial interests to offer something for every taste. There was Play Guy, Blue Boy, Black Inches, Mandate, Bear. Now, this magazine is part of an entirely beautiful subset of the porn world, specifically the gay porn world. Bears, which are defined basically as hairy, overweight men. And though I am not gay, I must admit it puts a spring in my step to know that my particular type of dad bod is of desire to enough people of any ilk to warrant numerous publications devoted to it. There was Bear, American Bear, Bear World, Bear United character and many, many issues of Honcho. Of course, there were also magazines just for women, women who liked men, women who liked women, women who liked either but were sex positive and adventurous. And then there was this, October 1973. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the image of the cover of the first pornographic magazine I ever owned. I was 13 when I found it by the side of the ruralish road where I lived. A dirty magazine right there in the side of the road. Thank you, teenage boy gods. And it didn't just have a suggestive cover. As it turned out, there were pictures of naked ladies in suggestive poses on the inside, too. Well, I brought it right back to my house, but I didn't dare bring it into my house, into my mother's house. So I kind of hid it in the weeds back behind the shed. And I would sneak out. I would sneak out and take a look at it as often as possible until eventually the rains ruined it, which was a major teenage tragedy. And I wouldn't actually own another dirty magazine until years later when I was in college. I must have been 19 or 20 and I had a summer job at an ad agency and there was a party after work and I'd had a couple of drinks, let's blame it on that. And on my way home, I passed a 7-Eleven that was not the one where I usually bought my stuff, and that happened to have no other cars in the parking lot at the time, and so probably no other customers inside to bear witness to my embarrassingly deviant planned porn purchase. So I stopped, and I decided I was gonna buy a Playboy, you know, to read the articles. In fact, I decided I was gonna buy a Playboy and a penthouse. So I parked the car, a 1978 white Volkswagen Rabbit, in case you're wondering, and went inside as nonchalantly as an awkward 19-year-old boy could ever hope to be, which is to say not at all. And I made my purchases. Let's see, bag of pretzels, maybe some Slim Jims, 16-ounce Bud Tallboy, a pack of Marlboro Lights, a Snickers bar, regular sized, and oh yeah, while I'm here, I might as well buy a Playboy and a penthouse. Well, the guy rang me up and bagged up all my items and then got the dirty magazines, which were kept in view but behind the counter. And as he slid them across the counter to my, I'm sure, trembling with anticipation teenage fingers, he looked at me and said with a wink, "Enjoy." Ew! Not only did I not like hearing that word, but I don't think I liked the way he said it or the implication I took from it. What in the world did he think I was going to do with these magazines? I mean, really, I was an English major at a nice college, a university. Did he really think I was going to go home and masturbate like some common business major? And even if he did, where the hell did he get off sharing that insight with me, impertinent pervert? But of course, I didn't say any of that to him. I just gathered my goods and skulked to my car and drove home and enjoyed. I think I ate the Snickers bar on the way, and I'm pretty sure I had a cigarette after. But I digress. Let's get back to the porn timeline. 16 years after the first Playboy, in 1969, Andy Warhol made Blue Movie, which was the first adult erotic film depicting explicit sex to receive wide theatrical release in the United States. It's considered to be a seminal film in the golden age of porn, as was Deep Throat, which was released in 1972 and really changed everything about the porno biz and everything that was swirling around the porno biz. As Hugh Hefner said, "If the film became mainstream, conversation about it became truly mainstream. Everybody was talking about Deep Throat." But its popularity also created a groundswell of anti-pornography sentiment and activism. And the pearl-clutching guardians of propriety, the congressmen and clergymen and community values activists who railed against pornography, were joined in their fight against this movie in particular and against pornography in general by the most unlikely bedfellows, feminists. the conservatives felt that it was a grotesque abomination, as well as a being against the laws of man and nature. And the feminists had a whole raft of thoughts about porn in our society, ranging from, well, some porn is a valid form of feminist expression in allowing women to take the power in the dynamic of sex, to the more popular feminist thoughts that it's just yet another case of the patriarchy expressing its dominance by pushing all manner of violence against women, and that pornography made by men and mostly for men absolutely perpetuates some of the most detrimental effects of having to move through this world as a woman, constantly being subjected to the male gaze. Porn was believed to foment unhealthy objectification, transforming women from people into objects, dehumanize and degrade, invite a distorted view of the body, create unreasonable expectations of what actual in-the-flesh intimacy might be like, and normalize abusive treatment of women, as well as being socially, emotionally, physically, and economically exploitative of women. The poet, philosopher, librarian Audre Lorde added to this litany with her insight, pornography emphasizes sensation without feeling. And this is such a terse and elemental thought. She was a poet, after all, that I had to add it to my collection of definitions of pornography. Now, eventually, activist, sex-positive women operating on the thought that if you don't like the porn you're seeing, make your own, did indeed make their own, a genre loosely called feminist porn and defined as pornography where the woman is in control of the sexual situation, she's in control of what is being done to her, and she enjoys it. Sounds pretty good. Gloria Steinem adds to our attempt to define pornography by distinguishing between it and erotica, noting that the former emphasizes dominance and the latter emphasizes mutuality, which is a key important concept. Others felt that the term erotica was vague and attempted to describe an idealized version of the kind of sex that people should want to have rather than what actually arouses them. The feminist activist and journalist Ellen Willis emphasizes the subjectivity of Steinem's distinction, stating, attempts to sort out good erotica from bad pornography inevitably come down to what turns me on is erotica, what turns you on is pornography. Smut. Which brings to mind perhaps the most famous definition of pornography ever from United States Supreme Court Justice Potter Stewart, who said, I know it when I see it. But once again, back to the timeline, because now we're up to the late 1970s, when technology gave the porn biz the greatest gift since the invention of movies, home video. VHS, Beta, and then DVDs and Blu-ray discs and high-definition pornography in sensor-round right there in your own home theater system. And along with it came a perfectly updated definition of pornography for this new era. But as much of a boon as all that was for the porn biz, it was nothing. It was nothing at all compared to the explosion of offerings and profits that would soon be enjoyed thanks to the new media in town, the internet. It's estimated that 12% of all websites are porn. That's about 2 to 2.5 million existing porn sites right now. Additionally, 25%, maybe up to 30% of all search engine requests are porn related. That's about 68 million porn related searches every day. And what, you might reasonably wonder, are people searching for? Well, these days there's really something for every taste and subtaste and sub taste. There's skinny porn and chubby porn, redhead porn, blonde porn, brunette porn. There's porn with black women and black men and Japanese men and women. And right there, if you listened really closely, you would have heard one of the main criticisms about these big porn sites. If you want straight white people, you just type in thin or fat or short or tall or whatever. But if you want any ethnicity besides white, well, you got to specify that. The big sites where all the money is are inherently tokenizing of any non-straight, non-white, non-cisgendered performers. That's really kind of not fair. Oh, sure, you can go to specialized sites for gay porn and trans porn and everything you can imagine porn, but by and large, porn today, just as it was in Georgia and England, is dominated by the appetites of straight men and the desire for straight white women, especially on those big porn sites. Of course, there are exceptions, but you have to seek them out specifically or just kind of stumble on them. For example, there's Japanese newscaster porn, which inexplicably is exactly what it sounds like. There's also menstrual porn and fish porn, which evidently includes having sex with anything aquatic, including cartoon fish. There are the self-explanatory categories of toothless granny porn and Santa Claus porn and clown porn. There's revenge porn, where a jilted lover or other disgruntled personage puts a revealing personal video online to get revenge on their ex. And hopefully there's revenge porn karma too, because really, what a shitty thing to do. There's virtual reality porn, most of which is filmed point of view style. So when users put on the VR goggles, it seems that they're right there in the scene with a porn actor or actress. Then there's the very, very, very popular genre of amateur porn. And of course, there's midget porn and feeding porn, not to be confused with food porn. There's real estate porn, very, very popular these days, but that doesn't really count. There's cosplay porn, short for costume play, and its cousin, yiff porn, which is people dressed up as furry animals humping each other, or cartoon versions of that. And of course, there's straight up cartoon porn, even if it's not so straight. The Simpsons, Scooby-Doo, Velma, and Shrek. Wait, is that Shrek 1 or Shrek 3? Or Shrek 69? Which brings us to an absurdly delightful digression, the ridiculous convention of naming porn movies by bastardizing the titles of successful mainstream movies, which is the perfect job for every 15-year-old boy who ever lived. Here are some of my favorites. I'll let you read for a minute. Getting back to it, there's also Japanese cartoon porn called hentai, and there's figurine porn. Oh, Miss Piggy. Oh, Kermit. And then, of course, because evidently nothing is sacred in the porn universe, there's coming on figurines porn, wherein a man orgasms on toys and Barbies, G.I. Joes, Hummel figurines, whatever. Wait, is that Woody from Toy Story? Woody, you're gonna want to get that cowboy hat back on. In related news, there's Wham porn, which turns out stands for wet and messy, where people, mostly women, clothed or not, get covered in all kinds of messy stuff. Oil, lotion, milk, custard, chocolate pudding, SpaghettiOs, anything at all. And they wrestle and food fight and just generally get splashed all over. That's what it's called. And this particularly peculiar corner of the porn universe is so popular that there's even a dating site dedicated to those who are into it. And I'll just bet my bottom dollar that nearly every person on that site grew up with this album. Which brings us back to fetishes, but now the other kind. Here, according to Gonzo social anthropologist and kink queen Catherine Gates, are the four levels of fetishism. One, I prefer women in high heels. Two, if a woman doesn't wear high heels, she's not attractive. Three, no high heels, no sex. And four, forget the woman, forget the sex. I just want to jerk off with the shoes. Probably nobody in the world knows more about these fetishes and desires than the most popular porn website ever, Pornhub, a free porn website which gets an average of 115 million visits per day worldwide and keeps detailed records on all of them, demographics, psychographics, age, race, gender, location, everything. Because one of the great truths of the internet is this: if you're not paying for the product online, then you are the product. And they're selling your information to everyone. 115 million unique visits per day. That's the equivalent of the populations of Canada, Australia, Poland, and the Netherlands. Every day. And the top things that people are looking for on Pornhub: Japanese, hentai, lesbian, MILF, which stands for moms I'd like to fuck, and Korean. No surprise, the country with the highest daily traffic to Pornhub is the United States. Take a bow, everyone. Followed by Japan, the UK, Canada, and France. And the average visit to the site lasts 10 minutes and 28 seconds for men, a minute shorter for younger men, and here's trouble, about a half a minute longer for women, who make up about one third of all visitors to the site. 11 p.m. and midnight are the most popular time slots to watch porn online, and Sunday is the most popular day. Viewers aged 18 to 34 make up well over half of the visitors, while viewers aged 55 and over comprise a mere 11%. And as it turns out, the top search term for old guys? Mature women. Similarly, somehow, the top search term in Sweden is Swedish. Other countries whose top search terms are for people from that country are Japan, searching for Japanese, France, searching for French, Germany, the Philippines, the Netherlands, India, Poland, Thailand, Greece, Bulgaria, Serbia, Norway, Luxembourg, South Africa, Croatia, Argentina, Brazil, and Russia. And here in the United States, the top search term is lesbians. Porn sites get more visitors every month, every week, every minute than Netflix, Twitter, and Amazon combined. And the effects of all this porn and porn consumption and male gaze and scopophilia and scaptophilia, well, it's not all good. Science is just beginning to understand the neurological cost of chronic online porn use. But it boils down to this: it's fucking with users' reward anticipation centers, the neural wiring that gets us turned on by our partners, or even just the prospect of partnering. As one neuroscience researcher wrote, porn scenes, like addictive substances, are hyper-stimulating triggers that lead to unnaturally high levels of dopamine secretion. When hyper-stimulation becomes the new normal, the old normal becomes hopelessly unmotivating. And yet the psychological community believes that porn addiction does not exist. Interestingly, what they've found through numerous studies and meta-studies is that porn use does not predict problems with porn, but religiosity does. This from a recent Psychology Today article. Turns out when a deeply religious person uses porn, it creates a moral incongruence between who they think they should be and who they actually are, which leads to shame and a feeling that they've fallen prey to some horribly evil force. And so there's a large self-help industry surrounding and perpetuating the concept of porn addiction. It's mostly online, though there are numerous in-person treatment facilities in the more religious areas, such as Utah, which also turns out is the state with the highest online porn subscription rate. So these are just a few of the newer issues for consumers of porn. What about the actors and actresses who make it? Well, the internet is packed with the stories of ex-porn stars whose lives are in shambles while they're in the business, and even worse after they leave. Harry Reams from Deep Throat, shown here rocking the porn stash, was an enormously in-demand porn star but could not find any acting work outside of the industry. He sank into depression and alcoholism and drug use, a very common story. And Linda Lovelace, the female star of Deep Throat, also had an incredibly difficult time finding any employment after the porn industry was done with her. Employers just didn't want to be associated with her. According to the porn agent, Mark Spiegler, the average length of employment for girls in the porn industry is 4 to 6 months. 4 to 6 months during which they do unspeakable things and make a few bucks and then are tossed aside to work no more. Very few will find an enduring career on either side of the porn camera, and job options outside of that realm become tainted by their past involvement in the business. Mia Khalifa, shown here, is a contemporary cautionary tale. She acted in porn for 3 months about 5 years ago. She made about $12,000 for her work, and later, in 2016, when she became the number one most searched for adult actress online, her work generated millions of dollars for the porn sites that hosted it, but she got nothing past her original paltry payment. Her videos will live on forever, however, just as the relief sculptures of Sumeria have, and knowledge of her involvement in porn will definitely follow her wherever she goes to for the rest of her life, for the rest of all of the lives that have been exploited in the name of titillation. But the financial rewards for their work won't follow them, and the right to say, I don't want this to be out there anymore, won't follow them. And all in all, the right to say no to any form of continued or even heightened exploitation will have been signed away, possibly out of sheer financial desperation or even duress, for just a few bucks. The professor and philosopher Helen Longino defines porn thusly: a verbal or pictorial material which represents sexual behavior that is degrading or abusive to one or more of its participants. And let's not forget that it's every bit as financially degrading and financially abusive as it is emotionally or physically. And none of that's okay. It's not okay for the actors, and it shouldn't be okay for the consumers, and it shouldn't be okay with everybody in between. Every single one of them, every single one of us is complicit. Dr. David Lay, a PhD in human sexuality and pornography, in his book, Ethical Porn for Dicks, A Man's Guide to Responsible Viewing Pleasure, lays out the reasonable argument that porn consumers vote with their wallets, and that we should be using that power to vote for a new paradigm of pornography. And there are opportunities to do just that right now. A whole slew of sites out there catering to this new sensitivity. There's Bright Desire, which promises a new and different kind of porn, feminist porn, or ethical porn, or porn for women. Pink Label, Bolessa, porn by women and for women, Lust Cinema, and Spit, just to name a few. Now, Spit features independent creators, and there are lots of similar sites out there offering a platform of porn which creators can share their wares and profit directly from their work and their image and their special talents, and cut out the middleman completely. And by man here, sorry, I mean, of course, the perversely exploitative capitalist patriarchy that's controlled modern porn since the get-go. Some others of these creator sites are Lustry, OnlyFans, where anybody can put their content up and negotiate directly with their consumers. Chatterbait, where you chat with live people online while you do whatever. Live Jasmine, same thing. The cleverly named Jerkmate, thanks again, 15-year-old boys, where you set your preferred gender, set your preferred race and body type and hair color, and then they show you a whole bunch of performers who match your preferences, and you pick one and presumably pay him or her some money, and then they do sexy stuff for you. Kind of like a peep show online, but better, because the performers only do what they're comfortable doing, and they keep the bulk of the money, and they can quit whenever they want. It's still open for abuse as lots of these private sessions find their way to the mainstream sites like Pornhub, but it's a start. And that brings us to our final definition of pornography, not a definition of what it was or where it's come from, and not a definition of what it's become, but rather a definition of what it could be and should be. People are always going to be titillated by representations of the physical body, and there's always going to be an appetite for porn. History has proven that, just as there will always be an appetite for coffee or chocolate or cashews or whatever. And my proposed definition draws from the transformations of the industries feeding those other appetites by suggesting a definition of pornography that's not exploitative, but rather organic, fair trade, cruelty-free, and sustainable. Pornography is anything created by anybody with the intention of being titillating to somebody. And it should be physically, emotionally, and economically equitable and consensual in all stages of its existence and for all those involved in its production. And when that becomes the definition in word and practice and expectation, and we all vote with our wallets for that kind of pornography, then we can all scratch the itch of our particular, perhaps peculiar, porn proclivities with a clear conscience and a happy heart. Now, go forth and enjoy.